Are you feeling edgy, stressed, and anxious these days? If so, you're not alone. Hi, everyone. I'm Dr. Mala. I'm the founder of Positive Health Solutions, where we offer you positive solutions for your physical, mental, emotional, and spiritual health. I specialize in psychotherapy, neurotherapy, and medical yoga. Welcome to my video series entitled Healing Journey, where I'll be focusing on the intersection of neuroscience, psychology, yoga, and mindfulness for impacting on healing, stress, anxiety, depression, general health, and spiritual issues. The techniques and concepts that I'm going to share with you are powerful, and research has found them to be very effective for influencing the healing of our nervous system, our emotions, and our mind. So these techniques and concepts have the potential to really make a difference in your health and happiness. If you're new here, please make sure you hit the subscribe button. It's free, and you'll get notified of additional healing videos that I put out. So let's get started. What is anxiety? Anxiety is typically consciousness that's stuck in the future, and depression is consciousness that is stuck in the past. Now, there may be some exceptions to this, but this is typically the formula you want to look at when thinking about anxiety. So the question becomes, how can I bring my consciousness back to the present moment, fully involved and just being mindfully present? When we're able to be in the present moment, a deeper feeling of centeredness and calmness comes over the mind and the body and the brain. So let's practice for a moment, bringing our consciousness to the present moment. So take a moment, if you're indoors, look at the colors of the walls, the furniture, clothing, whatever is in your vision right at the moment. Just be aware of the contrasting light, be aware of the form, and just really look as though you've never seen the color before. If you're outdoors, the same. Look at the trees or the grass or the gardens around you. Okay, now let's just slightly shift and listen to all of the sounds around you that you might be hearing. Some birds might be singing, or you might hear some humming in the background. Just really listen in closely. You might hear the wind blowing. Now go back and forth between seeing the colors and hearing. It feels so good to just anchor in the present moment. And when we do this, when we anchor into the present moment, it allows our nervous system and brain to shift gears. When we focus elsewhere and our anxiety is going wherever it's going, we have to learn to practice bringing ourselves back to that beautiful, calming present moment. So according to a new public opinion poll that was released in October of 2020 by the American Psychiatric Association, they found that 62% of Americans feel more anxious than they did a year previous. Now that's a pretty high increase in anxiety, considering that the normal levels and range of anxiety is between 32 and 39% of the population. Now, there are reasons why people are feeling more anxious. So if you're looking for solutions, you've come to the right place. So I'd like to share a story with you. Many years ago, a friend of mine shared a story of her sister moving out to Los Angeles. Now, her sister was a big fan of Paul Newman. And since she was moving to LA, she was hoping at some point she might get a glimpse of Paul Newman and run into him and maybe ask him for his autograph. So one day she was out with her three children and she went into an ice cream store to buy some ice cream cones for herself and her three children. And she was so shocked that there in the corner of the ice cream shop was Paul Newman. Well, she just was so excited, and she was causing a little bit of a scene because she was seeing Paul Newman in person, and she just wasn't sure if she should go and ask him for his autograph. So she became very anxious and excited all at the same time. And again, she was just creating a little bit of a scene. So she decided she just was going to get her ice cream cones and leave. So she gathered up her children, they went outside, and she realized, I don't have my ice cream cone. And she thought, oh no, I left my ice cream cone up at the counter. Well, she decided, I'm going to go back in and get my ice cream cone. So she went back in, excited and nervous, and asked the clerk behind the counter, do you have my ice cream cones? Do you have my ice cream cone? Well, the clerk said, no, ma'am, I gave you four ice cream cones. So she was like, well, where is my ice cream cone? I don't understand. And all of a sudden, there was a tap on her shoulder. And she turned around, and it was Paul Newman. Now, she just about died. And he had this little twinkle in his eye, and he said, are you looking for your ice cream cone? And she was nervous and excited, and she stammered, and she said, yes. And he said, it's in your purse. If you can imagine, she just about died. But they had a good laugh about it. She did get her autograph from Paul Newman, and everything was fine. So what does this story have to do with anxiety? What it has to do with anxiety is that from a yogic perspective, yoga teaches us that already embedded within us is peace. Yoga teaches us basically that our true nature is peace. And so we don't have to go out looking for peace, that it is actually within us. And so the ice cream story becomes a metaphor for yoga in the sense that our dessert, our peace, is hiding within us. In Western psychology, we basically talk about the same concept in a similar way. And we say that having a strong sense of self-worth and self-esteem provides us with a foundation that enables us to navigate the world and navigate stress in a much more effective way. It enables us to feel good about ourselves when we have that higher level of self-esteem, when we have that foundation of peace that we know is within us and that we can go there anytime mentally and emotionally. So yoga is basically saying that one of our answers to anxiety or stress is really not outside of ourselves. Now, sure, we can take the edge off things by going to a spa or getting a massage or going on vacation, but the truth is, if we don't change the internal wiring in our brain and nervous system, then we're going to be looping through the same response pattern of anxiety and stress over and over again. So we have to learn to rewire the brain. We have to learn the techniques to participate in rewiring the brain. Now, it is true that genetics can play a role in the manifestation of anxiety, but the techniques and strategies that I'm going to share with you today can still potentially have an impact on the genetic influence of anxiety. Also, I'm not against the use of medications for reducing severe or unmanageable anxiety, but even with medication, having some self-help tools can make a big difference in your anxiety and just feeling more in control over your life and your body. So really, it's basically that we want to rewire that pattern in our brain that continuously leads us to overactivation of stress and anxiety and the sympathetic nervous system. We want to bring our system back to the ventral vagal platform, that neural platform, and bring that more back online. So when we're in the throes of anxiety, we're releasing stress hormones such as cortisol and adrenaline and noradrenaline. And what we want to do is learn to regularly activate the opposing hormones that enable us to feel more calm and happy and relaxed. So what are those hormones? Well, I use the acronym DOSE, D-O-S-E, to explain some of the relaxing and calming hormones. So the D in DOSE stands for dopamine, the O stands for oxytocin, the S is serotonin, and the E is endorphins. The mindfulness and yoga practices are all about activating DOSE, those calming and happy hormones. When we do these practices that I'm going to show you today, it helps us to feel more in control and as if we have more agency over our emotions and our neurobiology. So these practices also help us to shore up the ventral vagal platform of the parasympathetic nervous system. In other words, we want to bring that neural platform more front and center in our lives. So a couple of thoughts before we get started on some specific practices. The first thing to understand is that when we're in an overactivated state through sympathetic arousal and anxiety or panic is happening, our objective is to downregulate. When we're in a depressed state and in that dorsal vagal platform, we want to upregulate. Now, the second thing that I want to share with you is that there is a phenomenon called relaxation-induced anxiety. This sometimes happens when someone starts to relax, and in doing so, it makes them feel more anxious and out of control, as if letting go and relaxing makes them feel really unsettled. Sometimes people feel more in control when they clamp down and they stay tight and stressed. So if you're in that state, please know that just dropping down even a small little bit will tremendously help to start to regulate your nervous system again. So if you feel anxious when I take you through some of the breathing and relaxation practices, feel free to keep your eyes open and also do only what you're comfortable with and just take it one little small step at a time. Lastly, the more you do these practices, the greater the reward. It's like putting money in your bank account. Basically, when you need money, it's there and you can withdraw it. So the more you do these practices, the more you'll have the capacity to start to impact on a dysregulated vagus nerve or basically a nervous system that is wired for too much sympathetic arousal. So we want to bring that system back into a healthy balance, again, activating that neural platform of sattvic energy, the ventral vagal complex. Years ago, a client came to me wanting to reduce her anxiety. She was finding that she was very anxious for no reason. She didn't have any of the markers, such as trauma or stress or low self-esteem or family or social issues. So it was a little perplexing. But in speaking to her, what I uncovered was that 6 years previous, as a 13-year-old, she had climbed a tree and had fallen 30 feet to the ground. Now, she was okay. She did have a slight concussion, but no broken bones or any other injuries. It wasn't long after she fell, though, that she started feeling anxious occasionally, and then her anxiety became progressively worse. So when she came to me for anxiety reduction, I was able to determine that her vagus nerve had become compromised and dysregulated from the fall. And when we started doing practices that regulated her vagus nerve, her anxiety subsided substantially. So I speak at length more about the vagus nerve in another video, but for now it's important to know that the vagus nerve is part of the parasympathetic nervous system, and when it is dysregulated, it can cause problems such as anxiety and other type of issues. So today I'm going to lead you through 3 techniques to begin the process of rewiring your vagus nerve and impacting on an over-anxious nervous system. I'd like to show you a few techniques for calming anxiety. So let's get started. If you could bring yourself to an upright position, sitting on the floor or a chair, I'll explain the process. The first step is to always attend to our posture. So we want to make sure to just slightly lift the rib cage so that your stomach and diaphragm muscle can move more freely. Okay, the second step is to activate that diaphragm muscle. So to do this, we want to gently place our hands on our stomach with the fingertips barely touching. and our elbows out to the side. Now, when you're ready to exhale, very gently but firmly, push your stomach towards your spine. When you're ready to inhale, just allow and release and have the stomach come out. So let's practice that for a moment. Again, when your body is ready to exhale, firmly but gently press inward. Inhaling, relax, and the stomach comes out. So go ahead and practice this for a moment. And have the breath be free and relaxed. No force or pushing it, just kind of allowing a gentle pushing inward. Relax and inhale. When we pull the stomach in toward the spine, it activates the diaphragm muscle, which is right below the rib cage. And this signals a hit of dopamine in your brain when we do this. Now, dopamine helps us to feel happier and more blissful and more motivated. Okay, this technique, again, is called diaphragmatic breathing. So you can relax for a moment now. And what we're going to do now is we're going to segue into what's called the three-part deep breath. For the three-part deep breath, when your body is ready to inhale, the stomach comes out, the chest expands, and the shoulders slightly raise. When you exhale, allow the shoulders to relax, the chest relaxes, and the stomach goes in. Okay? It's a rolling motion. So go ahead and practice this. So inhaling, stomach comes out, chest expands, shoulders go up. Exhaling, shoulders down, chest relaxes, tummy in. So practice that for a few moments. Nice, rolling, deep breath. Okay, now relaxing again for a moment. And now what we're going to do is we're going to focus our attention at the tip of the nose. So just a regular diaphragmatic breath. As you inhale, feel the coolness. And as you exhale, feel the warmth right inside the nostrils. So just take a moment, focus the mind, and begin to count when you're ready the length of your inhalation. With no pause, turn around and have your exhalation the same count. So go ahead and practice this for about 15 seconds. Nice, soft inhalation, and turn around, soft exhalation. Each time you exhale, feel your body dropping down, softening and melting. Nice. Just feel your body intentionally relaxing and just moving into a more calm state. Doing these practices has a powerful effect on our neurobiology. When we start to calm down the system, we're also impacting on the amygdala in the brain. The amygdala is considered the threat center in the brain, so it's always assessing threat in our environment. And when we do these breathing practices, we're signaling that amygdala to calm down and relax and to go offline for a while. Another benefit to doing these breathing practices is that when we take a three-part deep breath, we're expanding the pulmonary C fibers in the lungs. And in doing so, it releases a neurotransmitter called bradykinin. And one of the jobs of bradykinin is to activate and signal the parasympathetic nervous system to go online and to have the ventral vagal complex go online. So we're giving it a pretty clear signal that it's okay for the system to begin to relax. So I think you're off to a really good start with rewiring the stress circuitry in the brain. And we do this by countering the activating stress hormones. And we're activating those calming hormones. But the prefrontal cortex also has an opportunity to go offline, and it doesn't have to be so vigilant and in control. So basically, the prefrontal cortex, it can take a break and relax from thinking or making decisions. For this next breathing practice that I'm going to teach you, if you have any cardiovascular disease or respiratory illness or any other kinds of problems or issues, please make sure you check with your doctor and obtain his or her clearance before proceeding with this next breathing practice. So, for this next technique, I'm going to preface the instructions by first teaching you a few things. First, I want you to bring your attention to your pelvic floor and very gently squeeze in and squeeze up and release. Now bring your attention to your stomach and the diaphragm muscle. Pull your stomach and diaphragm in and just slightly up and hold. Good. Now relax. Now, the top part of the body, bring your chin towards your chest. Bring your shoulder joints in and down a little bit as if you're bearing down. Hold and release. We're going to be activating these four areas while we hold the breath inhaled. Okay? So I will clearly and gently lead you through this practice. Follow at your own pace, and if at any time you need to release or take a breath, just please do so on your own. Okay? So let's bring our attention to the base of the spine. Inhale up your spine all the way to the crown of the head. Hold the breath inhaled. Pelvic floor goes in and up. Stomach goes in and up. Chin down, shoulders in, and bear down. Hold. And release, exhaling through the mouth, slowly and gently. Take a normal breath and relax. Okay? We'll do it again. Bringing your attention down to the base of the spine. Inhale up to the crown of the head. Pelvic floor goes in and up. Stomach goes in and up. Chin down, shoulders in and down. The breath is held. One, two, three. Slow release through the mouth and relax. Very nice. Take normal breaths. Now what I'd like you to do is I'd like you to take about 15 seconds or so and do this a few more times on your own. So again, just a reminder, we're holding the breath inhaled. The pelvic floor goes in and up. Stomach goes in and up. Chin down. Shoulder joints in and slightly down. And you exhale through the mouth when you're ready to release. And take a deep breath whenever you need to. Take your time with this and just be gentle with the breath pattern in your system. You're probably noticing now that your brain and body is starting to feel much more relaxed and calm as you release dopamine, endorphins, and oxytocin into your system. And this is what we want to achieve, to counter the stress hormones of anxiety or panic attacks. So just come fully back now and continue to just be still and quiet and feel the softness and just the ease that's coming through the brain and the body. This is the peace, the dessert that yoga says is already within us. And the more you practice these techniques, the more clearly your nervous system and brain will begin to get the message to back off from sympathetic overactivation. And we'll be rewiring the brain into more of a ventral vagal complex arena, which is the reward center of the brain. So your takeaway point for today is, number one, find the peace that yoga says is already within you. That dessert is waiting for you. Number two, I recommend that you take some time to practice the rewiring of your brain and nervous system through these breathing practices that I showed you and taught you today. It'll be helpful to do these practices 2 to 3 times a day for maybe about 10 to 12 minutes each time. The beauty of neuroscience is that it explains how and why yoga and psychology techniques work. If you found this video helpful, please give me a like and feel free to subscribe so you can be informed of future videos that I put out. So until next time, I'm Dr. Mala. Take really good care and namaste.